young brother and able to speak the word and tell you more about it. And we're here today. And it could be our life.
Yeah, right.
We don't know. We don't know. We may not able to see the light of another day. I was with my boy yesterday, and he was telling me a friend walked out there where we was at. Your brother had a heart attack or a stroke, and a heart attack and a stroke. Made me feel for that man. I thought he was young, maybe in his 50s, didn't know him, but I had a feeling for him. Yeah. I ain't got no excuses this morning. They wouldn't work, some of them wouldn't, if I were told. There are no use to use excuses. Sometimes I believe sickness will be excused, and maybe different, but be as it is. What few words that I might speak, I hope it will be to the praise, or here's honor. And that we might, as a writer or one of them, or as a preacher was saying one time, think on these things. Got nothing in mind other than a few, maybe a few verses of scripture that I've like to speak from it a little bit and make it another. In Isaiah, I may have quit talking like I talked to a sister through the week, and I said, I've got to quit, go get this medicine. I just got to talk to some bad sister over there and couldn't talk. Well, she understood. Amazing. Sometimes we make it appear, maybe, that the law and the prophets would fulfill, which the Lord did fulfill, the law and the prophets. He said he came not to do away with the law, but to fulfill it.
That's right.
And it was fulfilled. And whenever he hanged up on the tree, when it all was written of him, they taken him down from the tree. Laid him in a new Joseph, a new tomb. And God raised him the first day. There's some things in the scripture, in the old scripture, will stand true today.
After all, will. Amen.
For sure. And in this scripture, Isaiah was talking, and I believe that he said, the one of the ones he's talking to, come buy me wine and milk. But he spoke of this before this, though, and he said, why spend your money for bread? Satisfy not. But come buy me wine and milk that satisfies the soul. Now that was satisfy his appetite for a while, the bread, but the bread that he was talking about, or the milk, and the wine will satisfy his soul. Then he goes on and says, down here, I believe in another place, 55th chapter of Isaiah, if I mistake not. And the sixth verse, this stands as true today as it was when it was spoken. And you may not agree with me, but I think it's true. Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he's near. Now here's the verse that I want you to understand, that he is true today for a man that it will forsake his way and return to the Lord. Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he's near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him and to our God. For he will abide in the Father. Mm-hmm. That is true today if a man will turn. Another in the old scripture now, another says if he will turn from his wickedness and do righteousness, his wickedness will not be helped again. That's right. But if a man turn from his righteousness and do wicked, his righteousness will not be counted for. That is true today, my friend. All that he died for the sin of the world. And David, even they spoke of David, whenever that he had finished. Now he was a man, David was a man after God's heart, own heart. He found David a man that would fulfill his will. And when he had fell asleep, he had served his people. When he had served his people well, he fell asleep and was laid unto the Father and saw corruption. But he whom God raised saw no corruption. Now you see there's a lot of difference in that. Apostle Paul, over in the next few verses, or several years, I'm going to say, from this time that we're talking about, he was in a synagogue teaching the people, the Jews, if you please, and of course they were some Gentiles there, or Greeks, and proselytes. And he began to preach to them. And he told them, now here's where Paul got in trouble a lot of times, but he didn't back down. He stood firm on the God of moving his mind, preaching Christ to the people, somebody that he had persecuted, wasted the church, and then had started out to preach Christ. Told them Jews, or talking to them, And they began to speak evil, I mean do evil. Brother, them Jews come up, not all of them now, but the Jews, which the word was first to be spoken to them, said, seeing you put it far from you, and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, lo, I turn to the Gentiles. Now, it was prophesied that they would first have the word spoken to them. And it was spoken to them when Christ came to his own, and his own received him not, but as many as did receive them, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. Now, they wouldn't all of the Jews, mind you, that whenever Christ came, received him. They wouldn't all of the Jews when Paul came, when Paul was to preach the gospel to many nations or to set up these churches, they all, the Jews, didn't receive him. Now, they got stirred up, so Brother John, in so much, whenever that Apostle Paul was teaching them, and they stirred up the women, I can't get the word that it was, the honorable women, as the Jews stirred them up, and whenever that they was broken up, they persuaded these Gentiles, when they heard this, they persuaded Paul that he would preach to them the next Sabbath day. And there come out almost the whole city to hear it. And boy, these Jews, they were stirred up then, that evil. And they wanted to, they got so rough that they spelled Paul out of their sight. That's what, when Paul was telling them, that seeing that the word was to be spoken to you first, but seeing you judged it unworthy of everlasting life, lo, we turn to the Gentiles. Now, Paul preached to the Gentiles. He was a chosen vessel. God told him there when he seen the light, whenever that Paul was stricken down, I'll show you what great things ye shall suffer for my name's sake. And my friend, that he didn't back down, he preached Jesus Christ to be the way, the truth, and the life. The way, the gospel is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believed it. It was first to the Jew and also to the Greek, as many as the Lord our God shall call. Now the call is went out unto the people, Brother George. It's up to the people to receive it or reject it. You can fight the church all the days of your life and go down to a devil's hell. The Lord has fixed two places that will hold a human family. One is going to heaven, the other is going down. And there's only two roads that you're traveling. You're on one or the other. And it's up to you, the road that we travel, to make straight paths for your feet, lest that lane be turned out of the way.
Right.
Now, there are a whole lot to talk about. There are a whole lot to be thought about. When Christ came into this world to call them, he called them by name, and he sent them out to preach his kingdom. To preach, the kingdom is at hand. He preached repentance to the people.
Amen.
John came preaching into the Israel, to all of Israel, he preached to Israel the baptism of repentance. preaching, I am not the light, but I come to bear witness of the light, of whose shoes I'm not worthy to unloose. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with the Spirit, with the Father. Whose plan is in his hand? He's gonna thoroughly purge the floor, Brother Gordon. Gather the wheat into the corner, but the chaff he's gonna burn up with unquenchable fire. God, I place to hold all the children of God. Got a place to hold all of them that fight God. You can throw all the clubs we want to upon the church. It will stand.
Yes, it will.
Shall I not find faith on the earth when I return? You're going to find it, brother. There'll be a few standing here upon God's footstool when you return. As the heavens are higher than the earth, he sends rain and snow down from heaven to water the earth and to give seed to the sower and bread. And it wonderful that deacons, this bread that a man can eat thereof and not die, spiritual bread. Spiritual meal. The bread that I give you is spiritual. You can eat this bread, drink of this water. Do not thirst. As we spoke that long about water that he gave her, she need not thirst. It's like bread cast out upon the water. We'll be gathered up not many days in. This bread that Isaiah was talking about, the natural bread he spoke of, and it won't satisfy. Just for a little while, maybe. But this other that he was talking about satisfied the soul. And now, go ye therefore and teach all nations. Now there's some more of the baptism. I don't know if it comes to my mind. I'm just going to speak of it. I go ye therefore into all the world and preach my gospel or the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. That's a sure promise, my friend.
Yes, it is.
And this is not the water running down 12 pole. That some speaks of it about sometime when he was talking
to Nicodemus. I believe that was the different water.
But this one that he said about, go ye therefore into all the world, teach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized, it is talking about this kind of water that we can take a man down and baptize. By that same Spirit,
you can be buried.
This bunch that he was preaching to. And now when Paul got through preaching, or while he was preaching, that they received him. Whenever that they received him,
see, my mind slipped there on that. I didn't know what I was going to say. See, when our mind, we get carried away sometimes and we forget. But as many as
hear him and believed it,
the ordained, they was ordained,
the one who was ordained eternal life, believed, and they received. Now the Jews, the Spirit of the people,
we've always got somebody stirring it up. It's been stirred up ever since the good Lord came. Into this world. And our sin, condemned sin, in the flesh. And where it's at, we'll have it as long as we live. Get up the flesh. Sometimes we fall as if we ain't here, not hardly realizing that we're gone. Yet when we see that we are, we should turn and back. If you follow the flesh, shall die. But if you through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, ye shall live. What I want to say today, if I say anything hardly, I want it to be for Christ.
Amen.
And I want men and women to go to heaven. There's nobody, Brother Johnny, that I can look at. And I don't want to look at them. I take them out and say, I want you to be like. Because we've got a different heart. If you've been born again, we're born of blood. He that's born of God is born of blood. We have a love for human things, people, that want them to be saved. If we want them to be saved, we must point you to a kingdom that God set up here of His Son. He set up this church, left it in hands of faithful men that He had appointed. Now, we might differ a little bit about this. I believe that every man that is called of God to preach, I believe he's called of God to preach, that he is preaching the gospel, the pure gospel. Some men will differ with me on that. They'll say, well, the man is called himself. But I'm telling you that if a man, if God ain't in the arrangements, he's just a poor spokesman. He may be a good spokesman in some way. For he called them and sent them out. And told them to go preach. When he left here, he was going away. And he told them, if I go not away, the Comforter will not come. But if I go, I'll pray the Father and He will send you another Comforter, which will rest and abide with you forever, and will bring all things to your remembrance what I've said unto you.
Yeah.
Now, brother, he never said this to me. He said this to his disciples, the one that he was leaving here, the one that he walked with and talked with and tutored them and taught them 40 days or something like that, containing to the kingdom. After that, he rose from the dead, and he said, I'm going away. And he gave them a sure promise that he would not leave them. He would go all the way with them. He would stay by them. They would be persecuted for my name's sake. But if they was happy to know that they was being persecuted for the Word of God. And He did stay with them. I understand, my friend, that whenever they was crucified, when Paul, now I'm not saying that how Paul died. I know the last 2 years, or about the last 2 years, one time or 2 years, that he settled down over at Caesarea. And all he received, all that come unto him. And no man forbid him.
There's preaching.
unless ye have believed in vain. For I deliver unto you first of all how that Christ died, how that he was buried, and how that he rose the third day according to the Scripture. And that he was seen of Cephas, then of the, was it James? Then of the 12. And Paul said, last of all he was seen of me also, sisters, one born out of due season, because I persecuted the church of God and wasted it. But by the grace of God I am what I am. And I wasted the church too in one way of thinking. I fought maybe in different ways. I'd say to the old preacher when he got up, well, if you're going to preach, why don't you go on and preach? Separate me back from the house. But there come a time in my life that the gospel that cut me down got a hold of me down in the inward man. I was born again, if I know what I'm talking about. I'm going to church. That little spirit that's going to come back, and when I get back to the Father, I'll pray the Father, and he will speak to another time.
Yeah.
It come back on the day of Pentecost, when they're all gathered there in that room, about 120. They was having a good time. They was in prayer. But I'll tell you when the happy time come. Yeah, I can see this, my brother. When this time came, how about the third hour, wasn't it? Or anyway, they was there in the house, and that comforter that he talked about, that when I get back home, I'm going to pray the Father. It came back. It filled all the house wherein they were sitting.
Yeah.
They began to speak with new tongues.
Yeah.
As the Spirit gave them others. Well, if they'd have been laying there, I believe. They couldn't hardly speak a word, but he glorified God in that tongue. Yeah, I can see a happy time. And I can see a happy time coming. That when all that are in the grave come hear the voice of the Son of God, and they that have done good into the resurrection of life, they that have done evil into the resurrection of conscience and shame, I see the separation take place. He will separate them as a sheep divideth his sheep from the goats. Now, you know how a shepherd can do. Well, they can tell them sheep, they can tell them sheep and separate. He used that brother George to let us know in the day of judgment when it comes out of how you're going to separate them.
That's right. Yeah.
Divide the shepherd. Divide the sheep from the goats. He's going to place the sheep on the right hand. He's going to place the goats on the left. Depart from me, you workers of all iniquity. I never knew you. Depart from me. And do everlasting. Are prepared for the devil and his angels. He fixed a place for the devil and his angels. He fixed a place for heaven. I'm going away. I'm going to go down. I'm going to go down. I guess I'm taking this
far. Take your time.
But I'm very glad to think I'm able this morning having a cry to you that we have a Savior in heaven that's sitting on the right hand of God. A mediator that you can take your troubles to. A sinner man, if you will, if there one here that went down the bedroad and wasted all of his living. Them two boys that was there, that went down, one of them went down
the big road, sold all he had, told his father, give me the portion of goods that belonged to thee. And he wanted to go on a journey. He wanted to leave father's house. He went down the big road and he sold all, he spent it all in riotous living, a rougher living. Wasted it. And then he got in trouble. When he wasted it all, he was in trouble, wasn't he? Yeah. He said he was, he'd wasted it all and no man did, and there arose a famine in that land. Boy, it's getting rough down there. My friend, if it's getting rough to you, say, cut loose.
Amen.
Come out from among the world and be separate. And I will receive you, said so. He wasted it all. No man give unto him. You see, after you've spent it all, you may not have no friend. You might have a whole lot of money. You wasted it all. No man give unto him. He got him a job. I don't figure that's a very good job. He's smart.
No, not very young.
He went into this Felius. A man hardy. Go in to steal and feed swine.
Believe that's the way he did it.
He got very hungry and would have eaten the husk that the swine could eat, that old husk, you know, off the corner. He would have eaten that. No man gave him that. He said, I remember. No, he's come to his senses now. Yeah, it came to it. I remember in my father's house
are bread and bread spark.
How many hard service did he have? He had plenty of them. And I remember in my father's house bread and bread to spare. And I know what I'll do. And that's what you ought to do. You ought to just get up and say, goodbye, old world. I'm coming to you.
Yeah.
From the heart, God will hear you.
Yeah.
There's no way that you can find where he'll turn you down if you'll come with a broken heart.
Amen.
That's right.
But I'll in no wise. I will in no wise turn you away. I know what I'll do. I'll just go to my father. And this was the right heart to have, my friend. I'll go to my father and I'll say, Father, I've sinned against heaven and in thy sight. I've sinned against you as much as saying in thy sight. I've sinned against heaven and in thy sight. And I'm no more worthy to be called your servant or your son. Just make me one of your hard servants. Yeah, just make me one of your hard servants. I'll just be willing to work wherever you left.
That's right.
One little break. Oh, my friend, if I never stand before you again and declare unto you that there's bread in the house of the Lord, that you can eat and be happy on the journey. There's bread to eat and bread to spare.
Yes.
There's a home in heaven that is fixed for you. Who will come and be born again of his spirit and live in the church and die in the Lord. And he'll raise you up the last day.
Amen.
Put you on the right hand.
Praise the Lord.
I'd rather preach the gospel of Jesus Christ and let everything else go and say, turn loose, sinner friend of what you're holding to. Be born again. Now it don't come with a great shaker. You just have to hear him a knocking at the little door. If he knocks at the door, open the door. I'll come in and accept it. You think that I'm getting paid for this? I don't want no natural pay, and I'm not expecting none. But
but I'm getting pale.
Yes.
This is a blessing the way I've been for the last few years or few days, that I can declare that salvation is in Jesus Christ, in His Son, and in none of us. There's no other name given under heaven whereby that we can be saved, only in the name of Jesus Christ. The one that shed His blood, gave His blood upon Calvary's cross, broke down the middle wall of partition, which was stood between the Gentile and the Jew, and made us all one. In Christ we're all one. In that one sheepfold. No wonder He said, other sheep Christ said I am, which are not of this fold, I must also bring in, and there shall be one shepherd and one fold.
Amen.
My friend, if you ain't in the one fold, you're on the outside. I preach the one fold. I preach one faith, one baptism, one Spirit. By that one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether it be Jew or Gentile, bond or free. And all been all made to drink into that one Spirit. That one Spirit. There's one fountain was opened at the house of King David for sin and uncleanness. Well, I don't know where to quit. I'll bring it on. Before I get my wife all stirred. But I can tell you, my friend, when this is gone, I'm stepping out brand new. That fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you who are kept by the power of God through faith. That's the best I know how to do. Preached unto you the word of God. And Paul went ahead and studied all their spirit life to the head of that lift off. Great little old man, sir, that I lift off. You know that. That's God. That He was doing. And I really followed my mind, and when I think of God, whatever, so. We would have told them, hadn't you ever better have it done? All right, go back. I'm out of course.
Back down to me, what you've been missing. Brother Cullie got us. Sorry about to get started.
Brother Cullie said that the Lord told those people that when that comfort was come,
bring to their remembrance all things that he had ever taught them. Now, I agree 100% with him that that was not given to me. That was given to those apostles. And now we have to get it by reading and by praying and trusting in God. I believe it comes from God. We're not saying that God is not the one that brings it to our minds. Because when we get up here and I stammer around about as bad as anybody that I ever heard of. But then the scripture starts to come and the things start coming to say. And I know it has to be coming from God because I'm not capable of it. But the thing of it is, this old man wrote a letter, and I, Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ. A lot of times we'll read that and it's just salutation and we look over it and not listen to what he's saying. A servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ to them that have obtained like precious faith as us through the righteousness of God and our Savior Jesus Christ. He was writing that letter to us. This man that had been with the Lord, that had handled with his hand, had reached out and took the Lord, and had put his hands upon him. No doubt many, many times sat and listened to what he had to say. One time that he was walking on the water to him, actually got out on the water and started walking. But he was a man, just like we are. And he looked around and saw those waves and everything coming at him. And he took his eye off of the Lord from there and began to get scared. And began to doubt and started to sing, "Lord, save or I perish." And he had to reach out his hand, "Oh, ye of little faith, why did you doubt?" Why do we doubt the Lord whenever that he has promised us? And we're all guilty of it. Every last one of us is guilty of doubting things that he said to us, because if we wouldn't, we'd never get in trouble, would we? We'd never take our eye off and start doing things and have to come back and, "Lord, save or I perish." But he said he was an apostle and had seen Jesus and been with him, and he has written this letter to us that have received, and this is to the church, that have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Savior Jesus Christ. Now, regardless of what we do and what we say, where we go and what we think about anything, there's none other name given, just like the brother preached, that whereby we must be saved. It's impossible to be saved without the name of Jesus Christ, without believing on his name. And now that's what he told us our work was. Lord, he said, that one time he said, "I must work while it's day." But and these people said, "Lord, well, give us the work that what we can work with." And he said, "This is the work that I want you to do. Believe on him in whom my Father has."
Amen.
Now you've got to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, or you're not going to see what it looks like in heaven and in world glory. That's flat and plain, but that's what it said, brother. That you cannot be saved other than through and by the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he said, "Grace and peace." And where are you going to find it now? It's got to be in the Lord, doesn't it? Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. Do you want peace and grace? You got to come to Jesus to get it. How do I come to Jesus? How do I come to this and get this? I guess I better close this book. We'll be here for a long time. There was one time that there were the people that come to God, and what they had to do was to, and Brother Cullie, you brought this to my mind. They went back under the law, and they began to do things. God began to give them a law back under back there at that time, and we say back under the law. But when they began to multiply here on the earth and begin to grow and get out and have a knowledge of God, and I believe that more than the Jew at that time had a knowledge of God, but that's another story. But whenever they begin to do the work, God said, "Now here's what I want you to do. I want you to take the very best that you have to offer." If somebody had a big prized bull today, you might look at him, and I've heard of some of them selling for many thousands of dollars in these places. Boy, he must have been a beautiful animal. Really just perfect, you know. And he had to be without spot or blemish on him. And you take this now, and you take it out here, and you don't sell it, and you don't use it for a breeding stock to really build your herd up. You don't do that. But you take it out here, and you give it to this priest, and they're going to cut its throat, and then they're going to take the blood, everything out from outside the camp, and they're going to fix it just like I tell you to fix it, and then they're going to bring it in here and burn it. Now, that's what I want you to do. Now, that was the works of the law, and they had to do that. To please God. Now, when they did that to please God, then God moved and blessed them, and they had more than they ever thought about having or ever would have. And you take, if you don't have that, if it comes down that you're just a real poor person and you can't afford anything, well, you just go out there and get two little turtle doves, and I'll accept that. But now, you task the best you can do, and that's what's required. Now, if you want to get into church today and do the work of the Lord today, you don't do that. You don't go out here and offer up burnt offerings.
No.
That's the part he was talking about that was fulfilled. That's already completed and fulfilled back under the law. When Christ came, he came to fulfill the law, because whenever that the Lord spoke back there and he said, "In the days of these kings," I'm getting two scriptures mixed up there now. But when the days of John, said the law was until John the Baptist came, and since then the kingdom of heaven has been preached. Now, the law and the prophets were until John. You see, I'm like Brother Cullie's not the only one that can get these scriptures mixed up in your mind. But the law and the prophets were until John. Since then, the kingdom of heaven is preached. Now, we don't go back here and offer up whenever that we touch a dead body somewhere. They had to have the ashes, and it had to be a red heifer. And they had to take these ashes and sprinkle the body to purify the body with it. We don't do that today. But brother, when we get out here today, whenever that we're purified, it's through the blood of Jesus Christ. That was the only thing that God would accept that was ever offered here upon this earth. And whenever that he offered that here upon this earth, it was for sin and for uncleanness. It was the only thing that was ever offered that will purge our conscience.
Right.
All the law and the prophets and everything that they did back there would not purge the conscience. It couldn't do it. But they had a remembrance every year to go back and to do what God had told them to do. And whenever that they would do those things, God would bless those people. And it was so wonderfully blessed. And so much of this now is coming to my mind that I'm trying to get about 14 different sermons, seems like, going here at one time. It's all just coming to me there. But what I want to get on your mind today is that we serve God through a different work. We say, well, we preach works, and you say that we don't do the works. We don't do the works of the law. We do the works of righteousness today, which is what God has commanded us to do through faith in the operation of God that He wrought in Jesus Christ when He raised Him from the dead. Everything that we do, brothers and sisters, we want to do for the glory of God through and by our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the one that hung, bled, and died and gave us this right that we have today, that we can come unto Him and do His work of righteousness which He has set up here upon this earth that we should do. Whenever that we begin to do the works of God and He begins to move down in our little life, friends, let me tell you, this world and all that it owns don't mean a thing to us. There's no wonder that the brother said that he would rather preach the gospel than anything that he'd ever done. No wonder Brother Tim Napper used to say, brother, I'd love to go. I've heard him say it so many times. When I go, I'd like to go right here in the stand. And I think I would too, friend, just like that. But bless the good Lord, whatever comes, whatever comes upon us, I want it to be God's will. And I want God to get the glory out of it, brother. And said, whatever I do here upon this earth, I want to do it for the glory of God. Because that grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. And He deserves the glory. I read about 24 elders one time that knelt at the throne of God, and they had crowns. I kind of think that they were crowns of gold. I don't know what they were. But in my mind, you can have it whatever you want. But they had crowns, and they cast them at His feet, and they said, you are worthy to receive it. All of this because you are worthy. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life. In Him is life. And that life is the light of every man that comes into the world. He likes us all. We don't have any excuse, friends, and we never will have an excuse saying, I didn't know you, Lord, because you'll all know me from the greatest to the least. And I, if I be lifted up, He said, I will draw all men. Oh, that didn't say some of you did. I'll draw all men unto me. And He was lifted up between the heavens and the earth. Friends, can't you see that? The call's going out to you. It's been going out to you ever since the day that He hung there on the cross back there on Golgotha's hill. And if you want to come and see what it looks like in heaven in immortal glory, you're going to have to let trust in Jesus. You're going to have to turn loose from your own steadfastness. It won't take you anywhere but down. But the steadfastness of Jesus Christ, the words that He wrote here in this book, or had written down. And but when you read this, read it just like the Lord was sitting right there and telling those people just what to say. Move your hand here and say this. And I believe that's exactly what they did. Because down in that chapter, that book that I started to read, He said, this is not of any private interpretation, nowhere in it. But holy men of God wrote as they were moved on by the Spirit to look, to write. And when He said it, every promise in there, let's read it this way, is positive. Every promise is positive. There's nothing negative about this book, nowhere. Everything that He said, it isn't a positive promise that He's told us, sinner man or sinner woman. If you go down, if you neglect me, I'll cast you from me. Is that negative? No, sorry. That's just a sure promise. As He turned to the other one, and He said, if you'll do my will, you'll hear me say, come. you blessed with my father, and I think of that so often. How I want to hear that welcome voice say, and that'll be the sweetest word that a man or a woman will ever have said to them. You blessed with my father, enter ye into the joys of the Lord. You've been faithful over just a few things. Now I'll make you ruler over many. Brother, I don't know who that was to. That might not have been to us today. But I'll tell you what I believe was to us today. The old writer was looking down our Brother Cullie, and he looked up, and I believe he must have been scared very bad because of what he had seen. But he looked up, he said, who are these? Oh, Lord, thou knowest who they are. Why, these are they who came up through tribulation and washed their robes. Lord, wash them in blood now. And this blood, we wash our robes and they'll come out whiter than snow. Oh, they had crowns, didn't they? And they had palms in their hands. And they were singing a song. They were singing praises and glory to the one that had died for them. Oh, but they're the ones that heard him say, come, you blessed of my father, inherit this kingdom that was prepared from the foundation of the world, prepared by just for a few. No, sir, everyone that will can come and drink of this water. Yes. Whoever will, this water is running free. Oh, you talk about they say there's no free lunches here on this earth anymore. But brother, let me tell you what. He did come and buy me gold without money. Buy me bread, I believe, without money. Buy me gold that's been tried in the fire. Buy me, it don't cost you a thing in the world. Well, I'll tell you what it'll do. It'll make you the happiest man and the happiest woman upon the face of this earth. You think that there ain't no one as happy as you are, blessed like you are, but God's got it for every one of his children that come to him. And God is no respecter of person. I've been so bad, you might say. But the Apostle Paul said he was the chiefest of all sinners, that he had wasted the church, he had persecuted him. Oh, bless the good Lord now. I see him on his journey, and it's time to close already. But I see him out meeting that he was. And he's on a little journey, and he's got the papers, no doubt, in his pocket. He's got a warrant for the church. Everyone that he finds calling upon this highly exalted name, I'm going to arrest him and take him down. I'm going to put him in prison. I'm going to torment him and call him the blaspheme. I hate him so desperately. Oh, they're not doing what the law said for them to do. They've got a strange God. They've got another God. But bless the good Lord, I see him, and I can see in my mind's eye, must have been a clear, bright, sunny day out on that desert land, and I see a light shining on this man that was brighter than the noonday sun. And knocked him down, brother, and it must have blinded his eyes, because he had to have somebody to lead him on his journey. But whenever that he began to ask him, who art thou, Lord? He said, I'm Jesus, whom thou accusest. I'm the one, Paul, that you've been so wicked and mean against. Paul, I'm here. I vow that I'm going to show you. I'm going to use you now, Paul, to let the people know that though you've killed my saints, you put them in jail, and you've done so many wicked things. Now raise up, and you go on down to Damascus, and there's going to be a man come there, and he's going to bring, you're going to see him come in, and he's going to lay his hands on you, and then you're going to receive your sight, Paul. I'll forgive you of everything you've ever done to me. Oh, what a Savior that we have. He forgives us of everything that we've done to him. And I'll leave you, Paul, and I'll be with you. You're going to suffer many pains for my name's sake. Bless the good Lord forever and forever. He did more than any other man that we can read about. Because God sent him, I don't know if he was any greater than any of the other apostles. But we've got more of his record than we do of anybody. But he said, it's not I, it's not me that's doing it, but it's
God that works in me. As friends and brother Cullie said, if it's not the Lord, if you can't see the Lord in us today, then it's just you're making a big lot of noise and it's not having any effect. But if it's coming from God, please, please don't neglect it, because God is calling for you today. Oh, come home. All of God's children, He wants to come home. We all belong to Him.
Amen. Say.
And I'd like for Sister Pansy and Sister Linda, if they will, to get down front here where Mike gets her. We'd like for you to come and welcome them into the congregation, if you will. And if there's a sinner man or woman here today that wants to make the same move that they have made, we'd love to see you come up and shake hands with them too. Give them a hug, how are you feeling? We're so proud that they both made the move that they did. And come, become a part of the body of Jesus Christ here upon the earth.
It's a grand and glorious feeling. Yeah.
is in your family, you can see the brothers and sisters of the church are there to kind of help you and hold you up. There's a lot of strength in
you. Sure.
A lot of comfort. So, I've got somebody to go to. I've got a brother over here. I've got a sister over here. I've got someone that cares. Me and what I'm going through with. And it's such a great consolation.
Yeah.
And I trust that these sisters will put their whole life into the work of the Lord. And when they do that, the more you suffer with Him, I can guarantee you, the more you rejoice.
Yeah.
Or the more you give your heart and life to Him, the more He's going to give to you. That's just the way that it is. I'm not talking about material things. But I'm talking about His blessings. The Bible teaches us manifold blessings in this world. And it may be material things at times. But He tells us, you know, you'll supply our needs according to His riches and glory. And I just pray, I want you to pray with these young sisters and the others that have recently come in to the Lord's church. Sisters, whatever you do, don't neglect you. That's a big part of it, because this is where we get our strength. When the Word of God is being preached to the brothers of God today, we can be started. And those promises tell us that regardless of what this world may bring upon us, we still have a peace. That makes us understand that we turn to Him. When we come into Christ, become a child of God, our life changes. We're not the vile person that we were. Our temper changes. We become more able to show grace toward each other. The Bible teaches us that we must grow in grace.
Yeah.
But we got it because of His love and mercy. That's what we need to do to each other, even our enemies. You know, we see people that want to avenge themselves. Mine, I shall repay. So pray for your enemies. And well, love your enemies, the Bible says, and pray for them to invite you. When you can do that, you're growing in grace and knowledge of the truth.
Anyway, I'm not through with nobody told me I got a call from my brother and get to the end. He's not able to hardly walk across the street.
Speaking of these ministers, so-called evangelists and so forth on television, that are getting great sums of money sent into them, and everyone is doing for them, they're driving their Rolls Royces, they've got big buying mansions scattered across the United States, airplanes, all of this, all kinds of wealth just pouring into them. Everything being done for them. And the man mentioned Catholic nun, Mother Teresa, referred to her. And what she is doing, giving her for those lepers and so forth that she's working with over the country. And she's even caught that, you see. And she's getting no money out of this at all, only her living. And she's giving her life to comfort other people. I know she's a Catholic, but what kind of a light is she sending forth to mankind concerning her churches that we care? That's what she said. She's not after what they've got, but they're doing for them. And these other men are after what you've got, and you do for them. We need to look at our own lives today, and what you do has been reflected upon this church. And what we believe, what we profess to believe. You do good to your neighbor, help any way you can the sick and the afflicted, and show them that you care, not expecting anything in return. But what can I do to help you? That is the life of Christ.
Amen.
That's what he does. He gave his life, his very life, for mankind. And we say, he said, if you'll suffer with me, as a promise, if you'll suffer with me, one day you'll walk with me and you'll have a promise. So let's suffer for Christ's sake. Do what we can for others. Visit those in the hospital.
Those who have been in the market, they're in the relationship.